Podsmash.
We are your hosts,
Penguin and Termite.
And we are where gaming goes to grab a beer.
Where gaming goes to grab some Christmas cheer.
Hey!
I thought of that earlier and I was like, I have to do it.
So this today, on this awesome Christmas day, we are drinking Trogs the Mad Elf. It comes out every year on the holidays. It's arguably my favorite beer. Might even be better than the Goose Island Bourbon County that comes out of Black Fridays.
Which we are also big fans of.
Yeah.
But it's good. I wouldn't say it's my favorite, but it's good.
You're like dumb.
It. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Penguin.
Like the things that I like.
Yeah, I have to. I'm forced.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. It's a wonderful time of the year. We are by no means intending to offend or alienate anyone who doesn't celebrate Christmas, so happy whatever holiday you celebrate in your family and it's special to you, but we love us in Christmas.
Oh,
so
yes.
This is a very special Christmas episode. It is airing on Christmas too.
Yep.
So for those of you who are super nice and going to take time away from your families or out of your day to potentially listen to us on Christmas, we are super, super blessed. Or maybe you're all sitting around the fire, listening to Penguin and Termite.
Like a fireside chat.
Like,
With the Yule log.
Welcome to the Christmas special.
If you keep that up, I think our listeners are going to drop.
Oh, don't be grinchy.
Get your big old Yule log and you burn grinchy. It in the fire and it'll last all day long.
Yeah.
And you'll have the soft, sensuous voices of Penguin and Termite whispering holiday cheer into your ear.
Yes.
How many times can we rhyme like Christmas Day, cheer?
Yeah.
We've already done it like three times.
I would like to imagine that we do this entire episode and it's a Seussian rhyme. That would be pretty cool.
I don't know what that is.
Seussian, Dr. Seuss.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like Seussian rhyme scheme.
Yep.
Where we
thing
just...
one and thing two.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got it.
Penguin and Termite are talking about games.
They're very rhythmic when you read them.
Internet probably just thinks they're lame. Okay.
Don't count your chickens before they hatch.
I hope not. But so what is going on? Obviously, this episode isn't being recorded on Christmas. So how are Christmas preparations going for the Termite family?
I don't know. So we have two sides of the family.
Okay.
Of course, I'm married, so I have my family and my wife's family. And usually we do stuff Christmas Eve / day. We'll split the two somehow, whichever's most convenient. My mother-in-law, she works retail. So I know stores are closed on Christmas Day, but sometimes we get together on Christmas Eve with my family so that we can do Christmas Day with hers. So we'll figure it out.
Sweet. What have you done so far Christmas-related?
I bought some stuff on Black Friday for people.
Okay. Did you put up a tree?
Decorated our house and we have a tree up. And I actually found a sweet deal. It's kind of a funny story since we're bantering. I went to go pull all of the lights out of my shed. So my shed's outside of my house. And summer here gets like 95 to 100 and some degrees with 100% humidity. It's absolutely terrible all summer long. So when I pulled the lights out now to put them on my house, the white bulbs were all black. Like burnt.
Oh.
Like they'd all like fried in the heat.
Huh.
So I was like, well, I only have 100 lights. I can't do anything with that. So I perused the Black Friday ads and found Lowe's had a 600 count tub of lights on sale. So I bought two of them.
How much?
They were $25 each.
Ah, I missed that.
Yeah, and each box of 100 was like more than six. So six times five to get, or I don't know, I can't do math.
Yeah.
You know, six boxes of 100 lights would be way more than $25. So the 600 lights, I bought two tubs. And I've hung an entire one and a half of another. So I have 900 lights on my house, and I'm not done.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I haven't started on the lights yet. I'm procrastinating on that. I want to do it, but I also...
You got those bushes right outside your house.
I got the bushes. I want to get some icicle lights because we got that cool, like, A-frame point above our garage. And I think it would be cool to put some of those up, even if it would be, like, stressful as heck. I don't want to staple them though. I'd rather get like some hooks.
Yeah, they make them. That's
so
what
it's just like it's just a matter of going out and taking the time to do it. So, but other than that, I did a pretty nice setup last year, which I was proud of.
We have a fake tree.
We got it
on sale on Black Friday a couple years ago.
The Abomination of Desolation.
It's
I am aware.
Lights already installed in it.
My dad
takes 2 minutes to put together.
Betrayed us and got a fake tree.
Now, I do have a 2-year-old, and when he gets a little older, maybe next year or the year after, I do want to switch to the real tree because I want him to have that experience with the family. Like, this is a night that we're going to go to the tree shops and look. I'm not into cutting it down, though. I'm not I'm not about that.
We did that a couple times.
Go to Iraq and buy it off the rack.
Yeah, go to Iraq. Go to Iraq and get some trees.
Do they even have Christmas trees over there?
I don't know. I'd like to think so. I mean, Santa delivers presents to Iraq, doesn't
he? That's right.
Yeah, so, but cool. All right. Well, speaking of Santa, I think we're going to go ahead and move into our DLC for the day. Downloadable content.
What's it got to do with Santa?
For those of you, it doesn't actually have anything to do with Santa. For those of you Podsmashers who don't know what DLC is, if this is your first time listening, DLC is a little game, a little bit that we do before we go into our main topic for the day. Kind of a mini discussion, usually something lighthearted and fun that we just like to, we just come up with a discussion and it's fun.
Yeah.
Usually a little game. So our DLC for the day, yeah, it has nothing to do with Santa. I don't know. I just used that segue completely willy-nilly. But it does have to do with Christmas, obviously, because this is Christmas and we're obsessed. So who do you think is the biggest Scrooge of this year in the gaming world?
Hands down, no doubt, EA.
EA, Electronic Arts, yes, I agree.
They stomped all over Battlefront 2.
Just completely money-grubbing.
And then tried to backpedal and recover in horrible ways that have all but exacerbated the situation.
Yeah, they are definitely a 2017's Ebenezer Scrooge. So in that light, I came up with a DLC that is, we're going to tell a little story, all right? So if EA, if we're comparing to Ebenezer Scrooge, I believe this year, on this day, this Christmas morning, EA is going to have a huge change of heart. They're going to change their business model. They're going to, going forward, they're going to come out tomorrow and they're going to announce, they're going to be like, we are abandoning these tactics. We don't want to predation. We don't want to be predators towards people's money and trying to addiction. So they're going to have a huge change of heart. It's going to happen this Christmas morning.
Awesome.
And the reason is because the president or CEO of EA was visited last night by three ghosts.
This sounds familiar.
This sounds a little familiar. Yeah, we're getting a little Dickensian action going on.
I like it.
Getting going on now. So they were visited by three ghosts, three video game ghosts. What three ghosts were they visited by last night?
You are asking for video game ghosts.
I'm
going to give you developer ghosts.
That's fine, too. Video game related ghosts.
All right. So I had to go ask my wife, who is much more well-versed in the theme of the original Christmas Carol and such. I thought...
It's dark. It's dark.
It is. It is. I thought that the Ghost of Christmas Past was highlighting the good that Scrooge had in his early stages of life, to contrast his current heart.
Okay.
To make him remiss and, like, miss his goodness and, like, maybe he lost his goodness.
Sure.
My wife corrected me and said, no, the Ghost of Christmas Past just highlights his character flaws as they were shown in the past, despite the goodness around them, to like, weave a common thread through past, present, and future to show where his condemnation will end.
Okay.
You know, at the end. And then, of course, that triggers his change of heart. So, I had to change my answers here as I was preparing a little bit.
Okay.
So, the Ghost of Christmas Past is EA Black Box, which was the publisher, or sorry, the developer, consisting of people from an older company called Radical Entertainment.
Okay.
Mixed with some EA folks that made Need for Speed Hot Pursuit 2, Need for Speed Underground 1 and 2, and the skate games, if you remember Skate 1?
Yeah.
Okay, those were awesome games.
Yeah.
Like, they were amazing. So the reason why I picked those is because it's still EA, right? But they did really good work that made a lot of good money.
Yeah.
And they've sown a lot of good seed with those titles. In 2013, they shut them all down. Fan of any of those games
that's perfect.
Today says that that was a good thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're all gone. Like, so... We'll never get the proper Need for Speed Underground 3. They've changed developers through and through. So that's the person that's going to show this CEO of EA. You know, that's like late PS2 original Xbox era. Mm-hmm. It's like the early 2000s.
And then
like,
2013 would be those developers would have been making games up till 2013, which would be our
PS4.
PS4 era. Okay, yeah. So the dawn of the PS4 era, though, yeah? Okay.
Yep. So the dawn of the current age.
Yeah.
That was a Majora's Mask reference. All right, so the Ghost of Christmas Present would be DICE.
Okay.
Okay, the developers who made Battlefield.
Battlefield 3, okay. Gotcha.
Battlefield 4. I don't know if they made the other Battlefield games that were around there, but I know they made 3. I know they made 4, and they made Battlefront 1 and Battlefront 2. And the reason why I chose them as Christmas present is because they picked up where Battlefield 3 and 4 left off, which were good. I mean, 4 had its launch issues and crazy bugs, and that's a whole different issue. We're not talking about that. As far as microtransactions and greed and, like, money grubbing, Battlefield 3 and 4 were not, they didn't have that, and saw the present EA move into those predatory microtransaction gambling kind of situations. So that's the present showing the connection between good old EA still doing dumb crap, shutting studios down when they shouldn't, and moving them into current, like, gambling stuff. The Ghost of Christmas Future.
Yet to come. Ghost of Christmas yet to come. The word future doesn't actually, I don't think, come up in it.
Excuse me.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm being quite nitpicky Dickensian here.
It's Christmas.
It's Christmas. Fine, you can have Ghost of Christmas Future.
Is the resurrected LucasArts.
They come back to take their own property.
And
I
they're
going to
show EA what a proper
Star Wars title.
Yes. And they're going to resurrect Visceral Games, the studio making a new Star Wars single player title, and they're gonna show the CEO of EA what Amy Hennig had and how amazing this game was, and the fans loved it. And he's gonna turn his heart around.
I love it. I love your answers.
Yes.
So I actually didn't even come up with answers because I wrote that down, and for some reason I just knew you'd have the perfect story to tell. However, I gotta ask for an improv bonus point here.
All right,
one more bonus question. Who is EA's Jacob Marley, the business partner who died earlier and heralded the coming of the Three Spirits?
I don't think I can draw an analogous thread.
It doesn't have to be perfect, but just like a competitor. BioWare?
Yep, because Mass Effect Andromeda.
Yep.
About what they were handed in the development cycle, and the studio, BioWare, is actually two different studios. And the studio that made Mass Effect Andromeda was not the one that made the first three Mass Effects. And so, like, EA's cycle of development and what they've been handed and what they came up with was the janky graphics and the massive fan feedback. It's perfect.
It works because BioWare is also working on Anthem with them, too. So I like to imagine then that BioWare appeared as a janky face ghost.
With, like, an
eyes glitching animation. Yep. All right. That's beautiful. I love that. That's our Christmas. That's our Christmas Carol parallel for 2017. DLC's done.
Done.
Wow. All right. We're way ahead.
Merry Christmas, you filthy animal.
We're way ahead of where we usually are. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Am I talking too fast?
No. This is great. I think the fact that I didn't have a prepared Dickensian tale to tell too kind of helped, but that's fine. I liked yours so much. I don't want to muddy it with my own.
Thank you.
With my own. You really did exactly what I wanted you to. Sweet. So, it's funny because I even had your notes pulled up, and I was still surprised when you said LucasArts. I was like, whoa!
Yeah.
That was good. I like that a lot. All right, cool. So, our Christmas-themed discussion for the day, we're just going to talk about Christmas. We're going to talk about our... We're going to talk about our favorite Christmas games, whether that's games we played during Christmas break or games we got for Christmas. We're going to talk about the sort of theme of winter. What are the games we like to play during winter that make us think of winter that we play on snow days? A sort of tag-on question to that is what we think are the best snow levels or snow environments that have been rendered in video games. I think that's going to be a fun thing to talk about. We're going to talk about what we want for Christmas this year and what we recommend you all get for Christmas. So that's our discussion today. So why don't we go ahead and launch into it. Hit me with your favorite Christmas games there, Termite.
So I got a bunch of Christmas memories because we always got games on Christmas. The ones that stand out the most, just starting off my kind of list of years, Nintendo 64 was the year we got that for Christmas, completely unexpected. I don't know if I shared the whole story in a previous episode. I think episode 0 has it. We had no expectation of getting an N64 that year. My parents pretty much told us that we can't find it. It's too expensive. You're not getting it. And then there it was under the tree.
Surprise, they lied to you.
Yeah. My mom actually found one at Rose's. Like, she didn't expect it. Like, she didn't go there to get it.
Yeah.
But I also overheard my mother calling every single store in Fredericksburg every single day, every morning.
Gosh, that's so nice.
Because they didn't have the internet. You had no way of tracking shipments and knowing when things were getting things. Like, you just had no idea. So she did the best thing she could, and that's call every store every day. And I'm sure she annoyed the crap out of all those employees. I'm sorry for that. But if you're listening.
Sorry, retail employees. Yeah.
But that's what you had to do. And anyway, so we got an N64, and it came with Mario 64.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a very fond memory of that. Mm-hmm. I've also talked in the previous episodes about my Zelda Ocarina of Time experience, my grandma napping on Christmas Day and me mm-hmm. trying to get Zelda in there. Fast forwarding a couple of years, we already had a GameCube. We didn't get a GameCube for Christmas, but I got Resident Evil Zero and Metroid Prime the same year.
Okay.
And so both of those games, I have very, very good nostalgic ties with the yeah. Christmas break, Christmas Day mm-hmm. kind of memories. And then World of Warcraft.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Dunmereau.
Yeah.
I'd always started the wharf around Christmas just yep. to run through that area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ironforge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. That's very good. The funny thing is I hated dwarves and gnomes.
You're like, stupid.
I hate them. I just didn't like their models as much, so I didn't enjoy it. But I loved that start zone. It was so much fun. It was such a good place to be. In fact, that's opening cinematic where the dwarf shoots the bear.
Yeah.
That is like, it always tickles me in the right spots.
Hopefully World of Warcraft Classic will tickle you in all the right spots,
I don't know, man.
I'm going to play it.
As a sidebar, I'm going to get it and I'm going to play it.
Podsmashers, get it with us.
But here's the thing. There are so many quality of life improvements that were made to that game over mm-hmm. time. Like, I don't think people are going to enjoy it as much as they think they are. Rose color, like, from just a gameplay standpoint, like, I think there's a lot of rose colored lenses
probably
nostalgia going on there. Because, I'll just say some of the systems, some of the ways that the game worked were not timeless. but that's fine. That's a complete sidebar. Let's see. My favorite Christmas games. I can't, like, recall anything that I specifically got for Christmas. Like I said in a previous episode, I won't go too far into it, but playing Star Fox and Yoshi's Island with my sisters when we would rent an N64. Ooh, that was fun. We always put it up on our big TV, which is great, too, because other than that, I mean, it was a cathode ray TV, too, but it was still newer than mm-hmm. The one I had in my room. I had janky old cat. It probably gave me cancer in the eye somewhere, like this old, leaky cathode ray tube that I used to have in my bedroom. But that's where I would play, you know, my NES, play Mario NES on that thing, and played Pod Racer. I would say that playing those games, Star Fox and Star Fox 64, Yoshi's Island, those when we would rent the N64.
Yoshi's Story?
Yoshi's Story, yes. I apologize. Okay. Yoshi's Story. Gauntlet, when I did finally have my own N64 playing Gauntlet. I mentioned that in the Thanksgiving episode, too. I'll say World of Warcraft, but I'll say specifically the last World of Warcraft expansion that came out in November. Because from after this expansion, they started coming out in like August. They started coming out as summer releases. One of them even came out in May, I believe. I believe that was either Cataclysm or Mists of Pandaria. But I guess Warlords of Draenor came out in November as well. Anyways, but there was like a stint of them that didn't come out in November. The last one that did come out in November that really made an impact on me was Wrath of the Lich King.
Yeah.
And it was perfect because it was a wintry themed Nordic snow-capped.
Yep.
You know,
I was there.
Ice.
Release night.
I loved, I mean, me and my roommates. Again, this happened in November, but I'll always think about it around Christmas time. That was such an eventful expansion for us because that was the first one that we did. We did like a party for where we all, you know, I was living with a couple guys at the time. We brought all of our systems out into the main room. We just LAN partied basically. Stayed up, you know, leveling all night. I had a couple friends that were like, "No, we're gonna level Death Knight," so they were kind of like separated. But then me and my one roommate, we were like, "No, we're leveling our mains, we're leveling our druids," and we just like power leveled. And I have some stories. I will tell you guys some stories about that later, about that weekend later, some other time, because there are some golden nuggets of stories there.
This is a family friendly podcast.
It's a relatively, I can family friendly find that story, but it's some gold, man. I'll tell you, I'll save that for another future podcast. And I'll probably tell you after this, whatever. It was like that. We called it Wrath Weekend because
Wrath
of the Lich King. Yeah. And it was just, it was good, like good times, like good memories of that weekend. And then recently, much more recently, I brought my laptop with me home last Christmas and played The Witcher 3. So I kind of recently have associated Witcher 3 a little bit with Christmas as well. Mm-hmm. So I might try to finish that. It's been a year. I've had that game for a year and I still haven't finished it. So I might finish that one up recently.
Ooh, but yeah, I didn't think about more recent games.
Mm-hmm.
Forza Horizon 1, it's a racing game. My wife, when we were early marriage, we bought a house. She had to work Christmas Day because she worked in a hospital in Richmond. Mm-hmm. And so I just had like the house to myself, and I had just gotten Forza Horizon. And for some reason, it just hit. Like, that game was just on point. It hit everything I wanted. I was excited. It's not even a wintry Christmas game. It has like the house music, like electro dubstep kind of like soundtrack. Mm-hmm. And it's not as like race simulator as the actual Forza game. It's more arcadey.
Yeah.
And it was just awesome. I remember like slippers and pajamas and playing that game. Oh, dude. And then Uncharted 3.
Okay.
PS3.
Yeah.
I got that for Christmas, and mm-hmm. then I had some time between Christmas and New Year's to knock it out. Because, mm-hmm. again, Alex, my wife, worked in VCU in Richmond, and I tried to take off as much as I could that week, and I just had time off to play games. So.
Nice.
Yeah, I didn't think about more recent stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
It's so retro tied, but actually, every year, there's always
something. There's always something you play it around Christmas, especially recently. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Last year, my mom got me an Xbox One for Christmas, which was a huge surprise. You're
playing Halo, yeah.
And I was playing Halo 5 by myself, and I played Gears of War 4 with my brother. So yeah,
didn't Halo 4 come out around Christmas time, too?
I don't remember, but I played that release night. Christmas thing.
I never played all of it, but I do remember. I do have a very clear memory. I went over to a friend's house because we were always play Halo together, and he got Halo 4, and his brothers were there, so we were like we're trading off between like three people, and I think I had to work the next morning, so I only literally got to play like 5 minutes worth of the game, but I still remember going and being like, oh, there's a Forerunner, oh, that's crazy, look at these Forerunner guns, and they're basically just human weapons. I remember that, but I feel like that happened around Christmas time. I don't know. We'll see. But all right, so that's our Christmas games. What are your favorite? What games do you like to play? I'll rephrase the question as, what games do you always want to play when you have a snow day?
Ooh, that's good.
Yeah.
I love snowboarding games.
Okay.
And it came back from, like, SSX Tricky.
Tricky!
Yeah.
I loved that game. Yeah. Again, I don't love snowboarding games, but Tricky, I'll always.
When it's snowing outside, I'm just like, I want to play some Tricky. Yeah.
Nice.
And then Dunbro, World of Warcraft.
Yeah, yeah.
I would frequently start new gnomes or dwarves around snow days just because I had time off, and I'm like, I want to play in a snowy area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a snowy area of Gauntlet in Gauntlet Legends or Gauntlet Dark Legacy. There's specifically a snow... One of the worlds you go to is very snowy, and like every single time... I remember I actually do believe I played that game during a snow day once. In fact, I believe we fought the like Abominable Snowman boss, and it's just... Every time I'm in the snow, I'm thinking of that game. I also, like, way, 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 way early back, do you remember Ski Free?
Game
on the Windows 95. Game? Yeah, where you get eaten by the snowman. Like, think of Ski Free a lot, especially when I'm sledding. Like, I'm actually out in the snow. I'm like, where's the snowman? Where's the abominable snowman? He's gonna gobble me. Think of that. I think this year I'm going to want to play... I'm gonna want to like crack open Breath of the Wild and go to like the Gerudo Highlands or the what do they call it? Hebra Mountains. I played that game in the spring, and even then I was like craving this time of year.
Yeah.
When I was going through those zones, and I recently was playing through them again on Master Mode. I'm just like, I'm just gonna wander around those zones.
I think at this time, this morning,
when you guys are listening to this on Christmas morning, I'm probably gonna be at my parents' house, and I'm just gonna like curl up somewhere and like play some Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Awesome.
And actually, similarly, I think I'll be wanting to play a lot of Horizon this time.
Yeah.
Too, because it's very lost.
Especially Frozen Wilds.
Yeah, a lot of snowy areas in that too. So, those are some recent things. I'm trying to think what other. World of Warcraft 2. Not necessarily Dunmuro, but like definitely some Northrend.
Yeah,
like I'd go up to some Northrend, play some of that. The other good one, other MMO that was really good for snow days is Guild Wars 2.
Oh, I never played that.
Yeah, it's got some really good snowy zones. And my friend who still plays it, he would. I hope he's listening to this because he'll totally like fist bump the air or something when he hears me talk about do some Guild Wars 2. Cool.
I used to like every time it would snow back in the day when I was a kid, especially with my brother, we would fire up Mario 64 and run to Cool Mountain and like throw the penguin off the edge and like do the slide.
Not the penguin.
Yeah. Oh man, we did all that.
I had a friend who'd go to who led me. He specifically was like, I want to show you something, and so he led. We were playing World of Warcraft, and he led me to a spot in Northrend where there's just like a crater, like or not a crater, like a little island that has penguins.
Yeah.
On it, and they were tightly knit enough that the island was just small enough where he did like an arcane explosion or some like one AoE spell killed them all, and I was like, you bastard. so mad. I was like, don't murder the penguins.
What are you doing?
They're my penguins. Yeah,
there's also so a Banjo-Kazooie level called Freezeezy Peak.
Mm-hmm.
I think I said that right.
So these are your snow levels.
Yeah,
then.
These are like snow levels in games that like I would go and find and play. So I have the rare replay on Xbox One that I picked up last year. So I'll probably fire up Banjo-Kazooie and get there and do that just for nostalgic sake.
One of my favorite snow levels in any game is not going to be surprising at all, but is the Snow Chateau in Twilight Princess. Zelda Twilight Princess, first you have to snowboard to get to it, and then the whole thing, you're in this, like, mansion, and there's abominable snowmen, yeti creatures there that you're, like,
he's cooking
the
soup, and you have to go find all the ingredients.
Yeah, and then I got the sense the entire time I'm doing this level, I'm like, there's gonna be a Megaton Hammer here, and then, that again, we talked about this in the Zelda episode, that was one of the, like, pleasant surprises for me, was... It was the same idea as the Megaton Hammer, but instead it was a ball and chain, and it was so
like,
bam!
What is this?
I was like, "This is amazing! This is such a good twist!" It's like again, it took a familiar item and then did like a really clever twist on it that made it really enjoyable. So that probably is my favorite level in Twilight Princess, and every time like when I'm like snow day favorite snowy levels, I gotta include the chateau.
Nice,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm. I love Majora's Mask, the area, the Goron area. Mm-hmm. I don't even, like, I guess Goron Mountain, I don't know.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, we have to use the Eye of Truth to, like, see the path and, like, everyone's frozen.
And you have to get the hot spring water and it runs out of heat after a certain amount of time.
Oh,
yeah.
That's so good.
That's good.
You get the Goron Mask and you roll, like, that whole dungeon.
Yeah.
Like, oh, so good.
Yeah.
We always talk about Zelda.
Every episode. It's fine. We just have to embrace it. Yeah. This one in particular, we were bound to. Is talking about snowy levels. Nintendo does snowy levels right. And a good recent example is the Mario Odyssey level. Chiltara, whatever that place.
Yeah.
Great.
Is
good
it
music.
Snow Kingdom?
Yeah, Snowy Kingdom, I think, is what the whole area is called.
I got to that spot, like, you fall into the well to go into the house where all the guys, the monkey-looking dudes, that race, like, where that area, and I just put the controller down and listened to the music.
Yeah.
I was like, this is amazing.
Yeah, Nintendo really hits the spot with...
Snow levels.
With snow levels. Yeah. I think at the end of this...
Go ahead.
We should... Unless there's something else you can think of, I want to almost say that Nintendo is, like... We should probably crown Nintendo the Christmas king of game developers.
Almost. Well, yeah, totally. I wouldn't dispute that. Mm-hmm. But there's a couple of...
runners up?
Yeah, I want to mention.
Okay.
One is Max Payne. It takes place in New York, I think. Or maybe a Chicago, a New York city-ish.
Yeah.
But graphic novel. It's like snowing, cold, and it's very dark. And it's a graphic novel-based story system that runs you through like each level.
Yeah.
So like I always have memory. I think it is New York because I remember the taxis and like the whole atmosphere of... snowy, dark, kind of scary, but not really, more suspense. And then The Division does take place in Manhattan on Christmas Eve.
Oh, nice.
And, like, it's this plague that wipes everybody out, and so it's kind of a survival, every human for himself.
Yeah.
It's a good twist on the whole plague. The people who got infected die.
Mm-hmm.
They don't come back.
Yeah,
this is not a zombie game.
Yeah.
It's, like, it's literally just, like, post-apocalyptic, but it's kind of, like, frozen at Christmas time because all of New York was decked out for Christmas when it hit, and so
everything
is Christmas.
Kind of,
even
if it's not Christmas,
and that's
good.
Made by Ubisoft, of course. Max Payne is Rockstar, so that's two third-party developers.
Yeah, I'd say because of our World of Warcraft memories too, Blizzard's got to be runner-up in there as well. Plus, like what they do with Overwatch for Christmas is really fun, and they kind of really hit the Christmas strings pretty good, too.
It's one of my favorite things about MMOs, or at least games as a service. Like, I will dispute whether or not they're good or not, but they always do the holiday events cool. Like, they have, I'm sure Destiny will have some sort of Christmas thing.
Yeah.
They'll deck out the main area.
Mm-hmm.
And I just love that. Like, I get excited about it. World of Warcraft did it.
Yep.
Final Fantasy XIV.
Guild Wars does it. Yeah.
Guild Wars,
They really, that's one of the advantages of constant updates, is they can always...
Those aren't Nintendo.
You can always change it, But Nintendo...
They do so well.
Yeah,
they
just,
so
they're
good.
Not even trying. That's the thing, is they're just like, let's design a winter level, and it always makes me, and gets me in the Christmas mood.
Yeah, I told you guys earlier that Metroid Prime was one of my Christmas memories.
Mm-hmm.
There's a snowy area in Metroid Prime called Fendrana Drifts. I go online and find the soundtrack of that level and just listen to it.
Nice.
It is the one of the best snowy levels I've ever played.
Ambience, I still need to.
It just captures what it's like when you go outside when it snows. It's dead quiet, right? And it's just calm. Like nothing is moving. You don't hear anything. That's what they did, but with the inclusion of some of the enemies that are around and some of the platforming. But it's like super quiet compared to the rest of the game. You don't hear any background noise. You just hear like some wind and like snow. It's just like,
gosh, I hope we get a white Christmas. So this good. Year. This episode will be so much better.
Virginia's never had one. I'm 31. It's a white
Christmas. We've had one.
Not in Fredericksburg.
I had one.
In Harrisonburg?
Yeah, it wasn't snowing on Christmas, but there was snow on the ground. We had the same on one. Christmas.
Maybe the same year or not. Okay, yeah. That doesn't count.
That counts. If there's snow on the ground.
It didn't even snow Christmas Eve. At least it was like 2 days before.
At least it counts as like a light gray Christmas.
Maybe.
Wow, you are a stickler for your white Christmases.
I've never had one.
I want one.
That's why I've always, it's a childhood dream.
So really quick, as just like a, because you mentioned like the silence of snow, as like a non-video game related thing, I will say, during the snowpocalypse that Virginia had, Snowmageddon, whatever they called it, back in 2010?
I don't remember.
I think it was 2010.
Right. It sounds right.
Yeah, 2010, Snowmageddon. I would just go out. I'd put all my gear on, and I'd just walk around because it was so cool, like especially in the city in Harrisonburg. The lights. It's like the snow. The lights would reflect off the sky, which would then reflect off the snow. It was just, it was, you could see for miles,
and
it was so cool. And the snow would swirl around. I felt like I was in a video game.
Yeah.
And I would just go by myself. I'd be like, I'd see like, hey, roommates, you want to go walk around in the snow with me? No, it's fine. Okay, fine. I'm going to walk around by myself. Like, see ya. Like, and it's just one of the coolest things. I loved it. I love snow. And we've got one friend in particular who's like a Scrooge when it comes to snow.
Yep.
I think I recently accused him of being the opposite of the White Witch from Narnia. And instead of always winter, never Christmas, he's always Christmas, never winter.
Now, do you think...
Ryan... Call out.
Do you think he hates the snow? He kind of masks it with the compassion of those who are affected negatively by the snow, which is a valid and true point.
Sure, yeah.
But do you think he's kind of just throwing that up as his validation for his hatred towards the snow to us who love it so much?
I don't know. He's going to give us his opinion one way or another.
Yep.
So.
Love you.
We love you, Ryan. But you're also going to be mad at us when you hear this. Well, I mean, he's legitimately had bad experiences in the snow. He's had it rough with snow. So I kind of like, if I had had as bad experiences in the snow, but most of my snow memories are like good memories, you know? Even shoveling snow is enjoyable for me. It's exercise. I get to be out in the cold snow and I don't know. I enjoy the whole experience. Like driving can sometimes be scary, but then that's also like, it gets my adrenaline going, you know? So I don't personally really have any bad snow memories, and if I did, it might color my opinion a little bit more.
But I've spun out and slammed into a snowbank, got my car stuck. That happened. That was amazing. I was so excited after that happened. I was like, that is so cool.
I'm in a racing game.
And then I remember driving home in a giant Jeep in the snow that was like the Millennium Falcon when it enters light speed. And you see all the flakes hit the windshield. It had that happen. And you just breathe. Like, during Snowmageddon, that kind of sucked because my wife was working in Richmond at the hospital.
That's right. I remember
And they actually opened up like an unused wing consisting of rooms and beds for the employees to stay overnight. And so Alex had to stay overnight, and that was mutual. Like, it was bittersweet because like she was gone, and it would have been so much better to have her there.
Yeah.
But while she was gone, I was playing games online. There's a 7-Eleven up the street, so I went up the street and like
hiked
got drinks and
like best.
And it's snowing, and I made it fun for myself.
Yeah.
But it was just kind of sucky to have my wife gone for multiple nights.
Yeah. I hope
that was
a
big tangent.
Yeah, it's good, though. Padded our time a little bit.
Oh, is that what you're trying to do?
That's not what I was trying to do, but it was good that it ended up doing so. Yeah, I hope we get... I'll say what I want for Christmas this year is not just a white Christmas, but it doesn't have to be on Christmas, but I want, like, a blizzard at some point.
If we had a blizzard on Christmas, that's a bucket list. Like, I'm done. I don't need to live anymore. Like, that's...
I've done it.
Done.
Forget my wife and my child. Kyle. Forget my wife and my child. I'm done. I can die happy now. It doesn't have to happen on Christmas.
I have a child?
You have a child, yes.
Oh.
Yeah, you know, Sam.
Yeah, I was thinking we would love having a blizzard around Christmas because we'd be stuck in together. It'd be awesome. I'd take Sam out in the snow. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Like, that's part of the bucket list. Check. That's why I was confused. You said that like, forget your wife and child. You can die now.
That's what you said.
I did. But part of experiencing that was with them. Mm-hmm. So like,
I'm going to edit pretty much this entire conversation out. We're going to pick up right about here and say something along the lines, yes, what I want for Christmas is some point in time in the winter, I want another blizzard. Like a good week-long blizzard where we got snow. I can work from home, so I'm not losing anything in that regard. So that's what. And I would even probably take like a couple days.
Yep.
To enjoy snow days. Yeah, of that week. Yeah. So that's what I want for Christmas. That's one of the things I want for Christmas this year. Video game related things I want for Christmas. I'm kind of on my list. I've got games that I want, I'm going to buy.
Mm-hmm.
So all the games that I've wanted, like, I need to have this game. I've already bought them. You know what I mean? So, games that I want, I would like to get. I have on my Amazon list. I've got Dynasty Warriors. No.
Fire Emblem Warriors?
Fire Emblem Warriors. That's what it is. Dynasty Warriors. I have Fire Emblem Warriors for the Switch. Because I'm like, it's one of those games where I'm like, if someone got it for me, I would enjoy it. But I'm probably not going to get it for myself. I'd enjoy it less if I spent the full price myself for it. I've got Assassin's Creed Origins on there. It's another one. I've never played.
Yeah, I can get behind that.
Yeah, I've never played an Assassin's Creed game.
Same here.
I played 5 minutes of Assassin's Creed 3, the America one, and I just didn't get into it. So, the E3 footage of Assassin's Creed Origins looked really good. So, it got me interested in the game, so I got that on my wish list. And I want to say there's one other on there. I don't know what it is right now.
We might overlap.
That's fine.
I might remind you of it because I want it.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
My top three games that I want are Uncharted The Lost Legacy.
Ooh, okay.
Which is like the DLC to 4.
Yeah.
But they're standalone. It's kind of cheap, but it's amazing. I'm dying to play it. Rise of the Tomb Raider. I think that's the one you wanted.
Yeah, well, that's one that I was going to buy.
Yeah.
So I guess it is on my wish list because I don't want to pay full price for it. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. That's going to be a good one for like snowy.
Yeah,
okay, go ahead.
And then Pokemon Ultra Moon would be amazing.
Yeah.
But I don't want to buy it for myself because I bought too many stuff this year.
Yeah. Oh, you know what I need to put on my wish list? I need to put Hellblade
on my wish list. That's on my wish list, too.
I'm going to snag that on there now before I forget.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. So for our last few minutes, we'll end this episode. We'll have a nice little shorter Christmas episode for our Smashers. But the one final question I have on my thing is what would you recommend that our Smashers put on their wish list, either for their loved ones or for themselves?
As far as video games?
Yes, video games. Yes. What would you recommend they get?
2017 is so good. Uh-huh. Like, stuff that we haven't really talked about already tonight. Maybe if you have someone, a loved one who likes Japanese RPGs, there's two options. There's Persona 5.
Okay.
And Nier Automata or Automata.
Oh, yeah.
Like, those are amazing games.
Yeah, I still need to finish my Nier Automata.
If you have a friend or loved one who likes horror, I don't know how to talk anymore. Resident Evil 7.
Okay.
Came out in January, which is a 2017 game. And then, of course, if they want anything Nintendo related and they just got a Switch, there's Splatoon 2, ARMS, Zelda, Mario Kart, and Mario Odyssey. Mm.
Yeah, we would, first of all, recommend getting a Switch if you don't have one.
Yeah. So those are my recommendations out there. And Horizon Zero Dawn, if you can find it, it's been on sale for like $20.
Yeah.
And they have the Frozen Wilds DLC. It's $15. So for $35, you're getting possibly 100 hours of content. Huge game for so cheap.
Yeah.
So good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, all the recommendations you made, I would make as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, and again, if you have a Switch and you want something Nintendo related, Mario Odyssey was great. Zelda's great. ARMS, Splatoon, if you want some multiplayer games, if you have like family... or other people you know who have Switches, I really recommend ARMS and Splatoon because they're fun, very fun multiplayer games you can all play together and enjoy and get competitive with.
My very non-gaming parents fought each other in ARMS. It was hilarious.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny. Yeah. I had some family members last time I was up in Harrisonburg who played ARMS with me. Trying to think of anything PC for my PC fans, my PC peeps. I haven't been in the PC gaming world.
I'm very happy right now. I'm just smiling over here. What do you got for your PC gamers? What you got for them? New drivers?
Yeah, I got some drivers.
Minesweep, I hear, is new.
Oh, yeah,
for,
totally.
For Windows 10.
Totally good. I would recommend, if you guys haven't, the new... I've got my friend recommended the new expansion to Guild Wars. He says, great.
Ah.
So if you're into MMOs, that's the thing that's part of the big reason I haven't gotten is because I'm not... These days, it's harder for me to get into MMOs, but... I would say that, check out Guild Wars 2's new, it's called Path of Fire, I think it is. You'd probably need to get Heart of Thorns, but they're all cheap, so I'm sure you could get the Ketchup bundle, and then check out.
I have a perfect idea for PC gamers. If you're into Diablo style games, Titan Quest, surprisingly, after it's been out for 11 years, came out with a new expansion called Ragnarok.
Oh, cool.
Not related to Thor Ragnarok at all, but it's called Ragnarok.
Have you, by the way, just as a side note, have you ever played Torchlight?
Yeah, one and two. Yeah.
All right. Just making sure.
You know, I give PC gaming a lot of crap, but I was primarily a PC gamer from like 2002 to 2006.
Yeah.
Ish. Later than that. But
cool. All right. Well, I think that's our episode for the week, for the season. For the holiday.
I wouldn't say for the year, because we're coming back
for the year. No, we're every week, man.
Yep.
We're
coming back through next the week holidays. New Year's Day.
We ain't taking breaks.
Wait, New Year's Day is 2018.
Exactly. So this is the end of the year.
It. Yeah.
It's been a great year, guys.
It's been pretty awesome.
It's been fun. And we're only, 14 episodes in now? Yeah. But we're 14 episodes in. We started back in August, September?
We started planning in February.
This has been a year endeavor for us. So we're glad that we launched
September 25th.
Yeah, we're glad that we've launched, that we're off the ground. We're excited about 2018. We hope to grow. So we hope that you all participate in that by sharing and subscribing. Write comments for us.
Please do.
Hop onto our Reddit threads and start conversations. We want to engage with you. We want to pick your brains for ideas. And we just want to, we're hoping to grow. And we hope that you all can be a part of that and help us out. And that way we can strive to produce better content for y'all.
And some iTunes reviews would be really good too.
Yes.
Because that like percolates ourselves and curates us to the top of the list for new
iTunes
people.
Is still the primary podcast platform. Yeah. So
if you could leave us a review, that'd be awesome.
Yes, that'd be great. So even if you've only listened to 5 minutes of an episode and you like that 5 minutes, say, I really liked 5 minutes of that podcast. It was great.
Yep.
That's all we have for the day. And we want to wish you all a Merry Christmas. Hope you all have a good time with your family and eat lots of ham. And we hope you get everything.
And cookies.
Yes. And we hope you get everything.
Eggnog.
And we hope that you get everything on your Christmas list. Santa, be generous for you this year.
And enjoy time with your family.
Yeah. We'll see y'all next year.
Merry Christmas.